I just sort of sat on the stories a bit, and we had a read of them and the outline and what we were trying to achieve with the History Channel, and I was curious, so I came on board, and I've done quite a lot of research over my career. CIA and this, that, and all the homeland and all kind of trade. It was a John Carey movie I made, and I've read a bit of John le Carré, like everyone else. I enjoyed the genre, and thought it was an opportunity just to look a bit behind these popular stories and see if we could unearth something a bit more intimate, a bit more personal about the people themselves, and the ramifications on a global politics.
I came to David with the idea. I've been talking to Chris in Alaska about it for a while, and Damon, as you know, has a bit of a history of covert operations, so it seemed like a very good match. Never before seen and never before told stories, and obviously, putting Damon on the center was something that made that.
Was he an easy cast member?
Yeah, I mean, he wasn't my first choice. But,
you can only be the best at making.
He won't go. The others, we had a certain date, he fitted in.
And did it change your initial idea once your brother came on board? Did it give
Very much. It was his baby. It was about being presenting, and the whole thing was with him in mind.
Okay. Then, on the face of it, I think an actor is somebody who wants to be up front and center, and a spy is somebody who wants to tuck themselves away on the old Myers Briggs sort of introverts and extreme. Would you say that they are opposite ends of the spectrum based on your experience? Bit of both now, or do they have similar character traits?
I would disagree with your statement actually entirely, because I think actors often are very introvert, and do find public situations and a sort of broader, sort of more public contact difficult. I don't, but we're not all the same, and I would say of spies. The old cliche that it takes a spy to catch a spy is often because I think of after a life of a sort of sociopathic compartmentalization of one's life, often I think they feel the need to speak, and I think their egos in the end is what gets the better of them, and they find themselves often actually confiding in other spies, and it's that loose talk, an increasingly loose talk, that actually undoes them in the end. So, of course, there's a need for discretion and a sort of an ability to be covert as a spy. Otherwise, you'd be a crap spy. You'd be basically James Bond, who is a crap spy. But what's brilliant about James Bond is his recovery is better than everyone else's, and that's where your 2 hours of movie happens. He's getting himself out of the massive mistake he made quite early on. But of course, in real life. So I think there's a bit of both in both.
I can't tell whether that was you just putting your hat in the ring for 007 or
excluding. No, because I'd be a very good spy, so I'd be no
problems. So Joanna, how did you decide out of all the spy stories that we kind of have heard little tantalising tales of over the years, and some of them are far more obvious and have been brought to screen in a fictional way, as we've seen from the series. How did you decide what to go for?
It was a really difficult job, actually, because the shortlist turns out to be a very, very long list. But what we wanted to do were tell stories from the point of view of the people who were in the room at the time. So that immediately excluded some of the much older stories, the kind of your Fulbys and McLeans, all of those. We wanted to speak to people who were alive and could tell us firsthand, and could give us that very, very personal testimony. And that's, again, something that we were both interested in, to be able to really make sure that you got into the mind of the spy through the spy catch-all, through interviewing the spy himself. So that immediately narrowed the field. But we wanted something as well that told a broader geopolitical story. So we wanted something that started at the tail end of the Cold War. So you were talking about your veterans who called the enemies, moving through to people like Hansen, and then culminating in things like the post 9/11 bomb plot film that we have, which is very up to date, and then this one which takes you bang up to Skripal. And even in the news today and yesterday, there's Oleg Smolenko and other people who've been exfiltrated from Moscow. So stories go on, and there is yet more to be able to do. You know, 8 is a lovely number, but it's quite a restrictive number.
There's more for another series, I think.
But it is difficult to narrow it down. But we felt that we had balance of the well-told stories, like people want to, but something you can get a really personal point of view to, and then something that people just really wouldn't know very much about.
Well, I think you're very fortunate, because 48 hours ago, probably half the people in this room wouldn't know what exfiltration was, but here we are, all experts. Yeah. How did you get somebody like Leon Panetta to sit down in the room and give you, well, I mean, he told you what he could. I felt that we were still being reminded there was other stuff in another drawer, but you got a lot.
Yeah, Leon's fabulous. He's a consummate professional, and he will not say anything that wouldn't be approved by the CIA. So you heard the sentence there where he said, of course, I can't tell you anymore because it's classified. And then in come John Cypher and Joe Austin, and they just tell it like it is. They come from a slightly different position. So they're happy to name Pateyev. No one officially within the CIA will name. So we got varied amounts of cooperation from varied people, but what we were really up against was the main body of our research was done at a time when the Mueller report was not yet released. So we even whispered the word Russia to the FBI, and you got the dial tape, you got the phone. So
and we lost the story.
And we lost the story because of that. Absolutely.
Because of the Mueller report. Because of the timing.
Because of the sensitivities of asking people from the FBI.
Too much classified information, you couldn't build a story.
That was exactly it. So that was very, very difficult. But that said, some people, once you win them over, and we have Russian-speaking specialists, we have French-speaking specialists, in the audience, in fact, who won people over in the period between 3 to 9 months. And an awful lot of the time, people just said, no, can't be involved, you cannot use my name, you cannot use my voice. And just by determination, you get through to these people, they trust you, and then you have testing.
And how did you decide what to reconstruct dramatically and what to leave as an archive, as a talking head? I mean, that's a couple of key decisions, isn't it?
That again was primarily about making sure that we told the stories from the point of view of people in the room. So we have a film about Robert Hansen, the traitor Robert Hansen. And we interviewed the man who single-handedly took him down. And so immediately you have this man's testimony, you then have to reenact how he went about it, how he stole the bomb, how he squirreled it away and got people to take information off it, how they faked a dead drop. So automatically, that is something that's going to come to life as part of the drama.
So if you're seeing it in your mind's eye, you think
exactly.
It lends itself.
And you've got personal testimony, they're talking you through it, and that's what you dramatise. And then there's little moments like in this particular film where you have to tell this through archive, and it's the stills of Medvedev and Putin. And you talk about their relationship and Putin being the lead man, and you have the still of two of them on a skiing holiday together. And they're clearly in cahoots. And that set of stills is greater than the sum of its parts. So that's how we kind of allocated different preferences, if you like, different visual preferences.
You definitely want to play poker with Barack Obama, I think, after watching. David, I've been told to ask you about the CIA. So your research for Homeland initially, and then obviously onto this project as well. When you did go to Langley, I mean, that's pretty privileged access. Are they easygoing, cheeky chappies?
Too much, because it was a sort of a summit between Homeland cast and writers and them, their field operatives. But halfway through, there was an extraordinary moment when John Brennan walked in, who had been CIA director, had gone to the White House and had come back into the CIA, and it was just post-Snowden, and he temperature in the room rose noticeably as he totally unsolicited talked about temperature in the room rose instantaneously. And then he looked slightly awkward and he shuffled out because he, I think he realised that he'd revealed too much of himself. And I spoke to his advisor afterwards, one of his assistants and advisors, and I said, "What happened there?" And he said, "I just asked him the same thing." He said he'd gone up to John Brennan after and said, "Sir, what happened there?" And Brennan apologised, just unreservedly said, "I'm so sorry, it was unprofessional. But what that man has done, the damage he has done is incalculable and irreparable. And I am so fucking angry." And he said, "But that's why I left."
Emotional side of a poker face CIA
man.
Yes, very briefly. So Dan, I mean, you couldn't have got luckier, really, could you, if you had lined up the ducks yourself.
Well, I have to always remember, I mean, when Gary Clay, when somebody said to him, "You were very lucky," and he said, "Yeah, the more I practice, the luckier I get." I think in history, the great thing for us as a brand is to approach sort of events which really affect contemporary culture, contemporary society, and tell the story behind them. And I think that with this series, it was an extraordinary spectacle to sort of turn on the news in March last year and to see people in biohazard suits making their way around Salisbury, and to realise that the Russian state had sponsored an assassination attempt on Sergei and Yulia Skripal. It was equally extraordinary that policeman, you know, then who came to their aid was then also near death's door. And then Dawn Sturgis, a few months later, actually died as a result of one. Now, there is always the interesting thing, and I think it's captured beautifully in the film, Alaska and Rookery, the whole team have done so brilliantly, is capturing the sort of human decisions behind some of these things. It's really sort of, you know, and it is, I think it's truly fascinating to sort of to try and get behind the kind of statesmanship and, you know, Putin sitting down and actually at the same time planning these operations. You know, it's extraordinary. And then the sort of G7 or G8 get together and discuss whether to readmit Russia to that group, despite this kind of thing. So having the sort of the very small sort of human stories behind it, I think it made this series what it is. And that sort of, and we did get very lucky. Alaska did a brilliant job in bringing these stories to life and getting some just incredible access. It's wonderful to see Panetta. It's equally wonderful to see Bob Gates. I mean, Robert Gates was the CIA director himself, became Secretary of State for Defense. You know, he's the eminence grise in many ways of US intelligence, and he was prepared to sit down. So I think brilliant cast list, but the real sort of skill of the series, I think, is telling these stories from a different angle and getting the story behind the story.
How long ago did you commission?
A year and a half, I think, that Alaska came to us with it, I think. So I think it was about a year and a half we started talking about it. But there is luck involved and serendipity, and the fact everything's sort of falling into place. You know, getting Gareth, getting Damian, I mean, the two of them together, that was obviously fantastic. I think there's a third Lewis brother, isn't there? We're trying to get on board as well. Want the family, want the full set.
I think he has the money, you want to get to know
him. It was just exciting for us. I mean, I think, and that's from a brand point of view, that's what we tried to do with Brexit and Al Murray, "Why Does Everyone Hate the English?" No shortage of material for that series. That's what we tried to do with Countdown to Disaster and James Nesbitt. You know, when Grenfell happened, it was a definite sort of moment society, and you know, you wanted to understand what lay behind that, and that's what we've tried to do with this, is really sort of understand how have we got to this situation. It's interesting, way back when I made a film about a Bulgarian dissident, Georgi Markov. Now, he was poisoned in London in 1978, 41 years to the day, to this day, it was an operation that was planned by a man called Oleg Kalugin, KGB colonel, you know, and it's really the KGB and the Russians just haven't changed. You know, 2006, it's Litvinenko, who's at Millennium Hotel. I mean, they, you know, Andrei Liboboy tried to poison him three times in London. Eventually, he succeeded, and Liboboy goes back, and he's appointed to the Russian Duma. He ends up in the Russian Parliament because Putin. So I think that there is a
fascinating to work out how have we got back to this situation that really is a relic of the Cold War. Mm.
Exactly. Yeah, it's the 20th anniversary of 9/11, what 80th anniversary, nearly 20 years. Have we, what do making a show like this, does it give you a fresh respect for the security services? Do you think that people's opinion and our reliance on them, our sense of our need for them, has changed in that time because of these special prosecutors?
Oh, that's a good question. Well, given all my expertise in the area, I can say yes. I think what's fascinating is that we're telling stories that go back 40 years, and still we're reading headlines today and yesterday about the, as Johanna said, exfiltration of operatives in a way that you would never have expected after the fall of the Soviet Union and the whole glasnost and perestroika. How we've come to this point is kind of mind-boggling, I think, that we're still locked into this kind of conflict in some ways, which is both sides seeing themselves as the aggrieved and trying to defend themselves, but at the same time doing all they can to attack the other side, and it is kind of amazing, and it is slightly worrying, I think, that we're in that situation.
Like, do you feel more kind of shady walking down the street and you're aware of cameras?
I think the more worrying side of things is more of a sort of the state intruding in our lives in a more sort of online way rather than this doesn't really have any impact on
Google just looking at you straight out of your computer.
Yeah. I mean this is these are exceptional stories about exceptional people that don't really most of our lives, but the fact that they are there in the background is still, I think, worrying.
I think that's an important point. The intelligence services are pains to point out, aren't they, that not every successful operation, or in fact few successful operations, reach the front pages, because it's all happening covertly. We tell a story here about the bomb plot, the liquid bomb plot of 2006, which happened within a year after the 7/7 bombings, where 57 people were killed on the buses and tubes here in London. And the story that we tell is three Pakistani guys who come back from Pakistan having been radicalized and trained, set up a flat in Walthamstow. And at a time when we were still trying to work out exactly how people were making bombs, we have CCTV footage, and you'll see this, I hope. It's a fantastic episode. CCTV footage of these young men in newsagents examining the bottom of juice bottles and then realizing that they were drilling small holes in the bottom. They then saw that they were buying Tang powder, which is this fizzy drink that's very successful, popular in Asia. And they realized that might be an accelerant of some kind. They had no idea. They then saw that industrial amounts of hydrogen peroxide were being bought, which you dye your hair with, which they did know you can make a homemade bomb from. They couldn't understand why fruit juice and fizzy drinks powder was included, or could be implicated anyway. And they then realized that there was a way of making a liquid bomb. And this is 2006. Now, a liquid bomb to us now, 10, 15 years later, seems like second nature to anyone. But in 2006, they were still grappling with...
Well, that's the whole reason we can't take liquids on the
plane. And that's why, from that moment, without knowing why, we were all told you can only have 100 mils of liquid going onto the plane. Because there was all covert. Massive plot to blow up airlines leaving here to the States in 2006. And the intelligence agencies got there, I kid you not, at the 11th hour.
Right.
At the 11th hour. It was a big plot. 19 active members, the same amount that were used for 9/11. It was to replicate what had happened. So just to speak to your point, because you were asking, will we have a different view of intelligence services? Well, you might have a look, as Dan said, have a little look behind the curtain with this.
Apart from Litvinenko's would-be assassins, those sort of key stories.
Well, they're crap at poisoning people. We can all agree on that.
Yeah.
I mean, it's thoroughly stimulating and thought-provoking. I just wonder, playing devil's advocate, is there a risk that we're being given too much information by way of entertainment? I mean, in the interest of transparency and just information, does this make the security services jobs harder, the fact that we have, and you have given us access to all of this information? How do you balance your response to this?
I think it's interesting, because Damian alluded to it, that actually the world of intelligence has moved on so massively, and actually it moves on at an exponential rate with the advance of technology. So cybersecurity and all the rest of it, and Huawei and whatever it happens to be. I think the interesting thing about the secret world is actually that perhaps not enough has been divulged, because they tend to